good way to remember it. Sounds like John
Wayne.
You don't have to call me that. One guy I told that to, he called me John Wayne for like 5 years. So I know a few of you here came with me, so we're familiar. I know your backgrounds. Some of you have known each other for a while. And I just wonder if those of you that came, do you have experience with meditation? Okay. How many are familiar with Buddhism as a whole? What about Chan Buddhism? Chan Buddhism is the Chinese, you could say, ancestor to Zen Buddhism. Anybody do reading in Chan Buddhism before? No, not much?
Okay.
I was also, you know, preparing for this talk, I wasn't so sure how to go about it because the topic is, could be, you know, really broad. Meditation, consciousness, clarity of mind. And it seems to have a cup, like each word has an element that could catch someone. Maybe somebody just wants to come to hear about meditation. So we can talk a little bit about that. And the word consciousness, it's used in Buddhism, it's also used in psychology. Very kind of can be a mysterious word, but maybe it would catch the person who's more interested in maybe analyzing or doing kind of more of a explanation of the mind, or that you're interested in that kind of talk. And then clarity of mind, I think, is just something that, could we say that all of us are looking for that? Would be happy to have clarity of mind. Would you agree?
Yes.
I don't know if everyone would be interested in meditation or doing intensive meditation, but for sure, I think we all want clarity of mind. And so I thought of kind of mixing it up. Maybe talk a little bit about consciousness from the perspective of Buddhism as a whole, and also look at it from the perspective of Chan Buddhism, and try to present something a bit more unique from my own tradition, as well as talk about, actually do meditation. Maybe a couple of short sessions of meditation, and introduce that also from the perspective of Chan Buddhism. And, by the end, maybe we'll have more clarity of mind. So, as far as asking questions or more of an interactive kind of thing, what do you think if I just give a, you know, just present something, and if you have questions, you could save it for towards the end, and then at that time we can have more of an interactive thing. And, but if I say something and that it just doesn't make any sense at all, and you need me to say it again, and maybe you fell asleep and you said, "Oh, what did you just say?" You could raise your hand, and then I'll try to clarify. So, and at the end, I think we have some time set for sitting meditation, right? Yeah. Okay. And does everybody have water, something to drink? Everybody comfortable? Important to be comfortable. And I thought about starting with a very short meditation, just because we all came from outside. We just drove in from upstate, and it's possible that just coming from outside, maybe our consciousness is a little bit, you could say, restless. It needs to be settled a little bit. So how about we do a really short meditation, a relaxation, and for the meditation, if you can, it's good to sit in a way that you're not leaning against the chair. And if the chair is a little hard, maybe you could sit on your coat or something.
Why leaning against is not good? You said not lean?
Yeah, better not to lean against the chair because actually the pressure on your back inhibits the circulation. Maybe you'd start to feel sleepy. So it's good to sit up and not lean. But if you feel that you have to hold your posture, then you can lean, it's okay. But ideally, we don't want to use muscle to hold our body up. So if you can, you could sit up, have your feet apart a little bit. You'd rest your hands on your legs. And is it possible to turn the lights down a little bit? So make yourself comfortable. And just be sitting for a couple of minutes. And so this kind of meditation is relaxation. This is really the foundation of any kind of meditation method. We just take a chance to collect our attention, and collect our mind, and just become aware of the state of our body and mind. And it's easiest to become aware of the body, how the body feels, if it's tense or if it's relaxed. So just get a sense of your body. You can start with your eyes. Maybe easier to close your eyes, easier to relax them when they're closed. Relax your facial muscles. Become aware that your head is upright. You're not tilting your head forwards, that your head feels balanced. When your head is balanced, then you can relax the muscles of your neck. Relax your shoulders and your arms. Letting your hands rest on your thighs. Relax your back. Make sure the muscles of your back are not clenched. You're not trying to hold your body. But just let the structure of your body support the back, the spine. And relax your chest down to your abdomen. Relax your abdomen. You may start to notice that your waist will relax. Relax your legs. Aware of the feeling of the relaxation in the upper thighs. Down to the lower legs. Down to the feet. Without trying too hard, just be aware of your whole body, sitting and relaxing. And as your body relaxes, you may start to notice the feeling of your breathing. And just let that be natural. You don't have to do anything with the breath. Just notice that you're breathing and relaxing. Then you can slowly move your fingers a little bit. Fingers and hands. Slowly move your arms a bit. And you can rotate your upper body in small circular motion. In the other direction. You can open your eyes a bit. Okay, and we're prepared to continue. So if you could get the lights again. Kind of refreshing, huh? To sit for a bit, relax.
Circle is to bring you back to.
Yeah, that slow movement and the circling of the body is just a nice transition from sitting still to moving and to being more active. And that's something we do with our meditation practice and our tradition, especially after a very long sitting. It's good to very slowly move and transition ourselves so that as we go from sitting still to moving, our mind is able to stay present, stay with this awareness of our body, what we're doing in the present, so that we carry it from the cushion to the rest of our daily life activities. So, in talking about this topic, meditation, consciousness, and clarity of mind, I'll be talking about it again from a Buddhist perspective, and a Chan Buddhist perspective. And again, Chan Buddhism is one school of Buddhism that developed in China, and it focused on meditation. Sitting meditation is one of the core practices of Chan Buddhism. But that's not it. Chan Buddhism really emphasizes this practice of meditation in all aspects of life. We can say this is also the case for meditation as the Buddha taught it himself. The Buddha had a lot of deep experiences with his sitting meditation practice. And if you've heard the history of the Buddha, his life story, you may have heard that he spent years in the forest just doing this intensive meditation, even fasting, and this lifestyle change which allowed him to completely focus just inwardly on his own consciousness. And through that 6-year exploration, doing a lot of sitting, he had some insights. And when he taught, though, he taught people, well, not that you have to sit there in meditation for 6 years in order to get benefit from meditation, or that you have to use the same exact way that the Buddha used himself. But he taught that there's actually how many different methods of Buddhist practice? Maybe somebody knows. How many methods are there?
84,000.
84,000 and maybe some more. Which is just a number which describes the fact that there are so many countless approaches to meditation and also to a lifestyle of awareness. A lifestyle which is, as the Buddha described it, an awakened lifestyle. A way of living, a way of using our consciousness so that we experience peace, freedom, not only in the cushion, enjoying sitting, but in the most complicated situations. And also looking back at the Buddha's life story, he sat for 6 years. He was pretty much by himself, wasn't doing much of any communication with anyone. His friends left him, if you remember that. His friends were all meditating together. But once the Buddha started to have a little bit more, a bigger breakfast, a bigger lunch, and maybe even a little supper, they said, "Oh man, you've lost the way of, you know, you've lost the mind for practice," and they left him. So he was alone for years, but as you can see from his life story after his insight, or after his enlightenment, as it's called, he was very active, traveling, teaching. And there were even some instances where you could say he got involved in politics. The Buddha didn't run for office, but there were many kings or government officials or people in these positions of great influence over society that sought his counsel. And so he wasn't, choosing parties and, I'm with this guy, but he was giving advice and actually interacting, dealing with a lot of complicated situations. But he was able to maintain that clarity of mind and maintain that mastery over his own consciousness. So the practice of Buddha Dharma, of Buddhism as a whole, and Chan practice really both emphasize bringing this meditation with this understanding of consciousness and then this mastery of our own consciousness into all of daily life. So I hope to get there at some point today, but I'd like to start with something maybe a little more technical. A little bit of technical stuff, or more of a look at the mind from Buddhist psychology. Has anybody looked into the manuals of Buddhist psychology?
Yes.
Yeah? Some of it is incredibly in-depth. I'm afraid I won't go as in-depth as these shastras.
Oh, that's good.
Or things like that. But you can see from the early teachings, the early talks of the Buddha, what he's talking about is how the mind works, describing it, as well as helping people to first have the right view, which is a conceptual understanding of the practice and where are you going with the practice. Okay, I want to meditate, I want clarity of mind, but what does that mean? And how do I get there? What's the final destination? And what might I bump into along the way? If we didn't have this conceptual understanding and we just said, well, just meditate just like the Buddha, no problem. It's okay, but you may be there for 6 years, 10 years, 15 years, and it's possible that if we don't have this guidance or this map of what's called right view, we may end up at a place where we're not sure what's happening. We're not sure what's happening with our consciousness. We're not sure if we're doing it right. We're not sure where we're going to end up. So, the Buddha emphasized this right view, which is part of the Eightfold Noble Path. Have you heard of that? And where does this fit in the Eightfold Path?
It's the first branch.
Yeah? It's the first one that the Buddha talks about, or the first on the list, because it's basically the whole guideline for how to practice, how to use meditation to cultivate this mastery of our consciousness. So part of that right view also has to do with just understanding our present condition. What is the condition of our mind? And within this past sitting that we just did, it was just a couple of minutes. As you were relaxing, what was your experience of your condition of your body and mind? If you could just say one word or two of what you felt, what you experienced.
Tired.
Tired? Some tension at first, yeah. And you say
soft.
The softness of the body after relaxing.
And the mind
as well.
I feel floating.
Floating.
Yeah.
Hmm. Kind of light feeling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Peaceful.
Peaceful.
Always aware. And the longer I sit, the more aware it seems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So some tension, comfortable feeling, maybe some tension, uncomfortable feeling, relaxation, lightness, maybe it's more comfortable. What about thoughts? Did you notice that, well, once you started relaxing, you realize that the mind has some chattering going on? You're wondering, well, we're relaxing now, what's going to come next? When's he going to start? How long are we sitting for? Or, right when I said, okay, now move your fingers, maybe you thought, I don't want to move yet, I'm floating, I feel so good. We have to finish already? Why don't we just sit for the whole period? Don't talk, let's just sit together. Possible that the mind has these various reactions. People who sit for a long period of time, you may also start to see the different layers of these reactions of the mind. And the more you sit, we may start to see that, wow, there's lots of thoughts happening in our mind. Lots of, say, maybe noise, chatter. Now, do you find that in daily life sometimes the chatter of the mind can interfere with what we're doing? It's like you came to the talk, you want to pay attention, but maybe you're tired, or maybe hungry, and again the chatter starts. Oh, I just want to take a nap. Or, what's for dinner? Yeah, I think a few of us are going for dinner afterwards. I wonder where we're going to go. And the chatter may start to interfere with being able to focus, being able to be present. And you know, when I came, we were driving here, and we came here, we drove down, we came very early, because I like to come early so we can just relax and take our time. We were walking like slow pokes through the city. We went to a place and sat down and had some fruit, which is nice. Very comfortable, nice little park. You could say it's a pleasant environment. And people that I was with, one person asked, hey, are you nervous? Are you nervous before you do something like this, give a talk? I said, yeah, actually I am a little bit nervous. And it's funny. Now, why get nervous? Do you experience nervousness in your life? Anybody? Anxiety? Nervousness? Is anybody free from that? Maybe some people are quite free of that, but completely free of that. That would be something else. And then why are we nervous? Maybe somebody could say, what could be a cause of nervousness?
Fear.
Fear. So what are we afraid of?
Rejection.
Rejection? What else happens when we're nervous? There's a fear there. At the same time, if we're afraid of rejection, we probably also, what else? We don't want to be rejected. We want...
Approval,
to be accepted. And are we afraid of being rejected at this present moment? Or are we afraid of some kind of situation in the future?
In the future.
So it's like this nervousness, interesting, sitting there eating an apple, but at the same time there's a few thoughts of, wonder what it's going to be like. Wonder how many people are going to be there. Wonder if I should talk about this. What if it's going to be good? Kind of thoughts like that creep in, and the mind starts to, wait a second, I'm not enjoying this apple very much anymore. What's happening? So, we all experience that. It's kind of the mind jumps to the future before we even need it. We don't need to think of that, need to wonder, need to want to have approval, or to be afraid of being rejected, but our mind has already jumped there. What else? Other than jumping to the future, the mind often jumps to the past. And it jumps to the past because maybe something happens, we remember how bad it was. Or maybe how good it was. If it was good, we probably feel, I did well. And it's been a long time since we've done well, but we're still patting ourselves on the back. Yeah, I've done very well. If it was terrible, if we feel that it wasn't so good, maybe we really carry that burden on ourselves and think, wow, why was it so terrible? I prepared for so long. I prepared 10 days for this talk. Or whatever we prepare for in our life, maybe we spend a lot of time preparing for this one moment in time. And so preparing is thinking for the future, and we need to do that. I think it's safe to say we have to think of the future in order to function. But at the same time, we may start to think of the future and think in a way which is not so skillful. We use our consciousness in not a very skillful way sometimes. So the thinking of the future becomes worrying. And we happen to be not constructive at that point, but actually rehashing maybe similar thoughts, similar anxieties again and again. So we're actually, we feel like we're preparing. We're actually just worrying for a long time. And the same with the past. It seems we can spend a lot of time with our mind either in the past or in the future trying to get what we want or avoid what we don't want and trying to set everything up so that it's perfect. Now, how could I do everything perfect so that I make sure it turns out this way or that way? And maybe we spend, how many hours of our life could we spend thinking of the past and the future rather than really being present? Just eating an apple, enjoying the apple. Or just sitting at a talk, just listening, maybe not waiting for something. When's the good stuff coming? Come on, stop with this, I know this already. Where's the good stuff? How much time in our life do we spend doing that? Who knows? Touch and thought, or mental activity. It's basically sensation or awareness related to our sense faculties. Eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind, meaning more internal. Again, if you want to look really deep into this, there's something called the Abhidharma. Some of you went to a retreat recently, which is a very detailed explanation of how consciousness works. It's just an explanation, but it is actually used for guiding practitioners in meditation, how to become aware of how consciousness is working. And with the first five, it's pretty straightforward. Seeing, hearing, we can all get a good sense of that. This sixth sense, or the sixth consciousness, can be more complicated in that it has a lot of functions. The previous functions are pretty direct. Our eyes just have seeing. Our ears are for hearing. But again, that sixth consciousness has a function of thinking. That's one kind, which includes generating images. When we think, we have to have images, right? If you think without images, we have language. So, thinking is language, it's images, which are internal sounds, and then internal pictures. These things can be memories of the past, previous impressions, or what else for the future. Maybe we haven't seen something yet, but imagination. We can create images, create scenery. When we dream, maybe that's probably the time that we're most creative. Our mind is not in contact with the previous senses, but it's purely in the realm of images, imagination, and creating all kinds of situations. So just like we dream at night, actually all day, we could say, this function of the mind is conjuring up dreams, in a sense. It's used to function, we need to plan, again, we need to remember, but essentially they're images, they're symbols. And at the same time, the sixth consciousness also relates to the other five consciousnesses. And for example, when we want to pay attention to something, you know, can our eyes just do it by themselves? If the eyes and the ears could work by themselves, then when we're dead, we could still walk around and do all sorts of things. So actually, there's that function of awareness which can bring attention to the various senses. The mind now pays attention to a particular sense, or directs that sense organ, and as we're seeing, or as we're hearing, we're also generating images. Right? It's like when you're crossing the street, if we just look at a sign, and we purely looked at the sign, without making a connection or association, would we know where we are? Maybe say, yeah, I know there's a coffee shop right here. I don't need the sign. But if we looked over here, and we didn't make the association that this is a coffee shop, would we know where we are? Actually, we wouldn't. We would be aware that we're seeing things, that we're hearing things, but we wouldn't be able to say, oh, I'm on such and such a street, Fifth Avenue and something. Where are we now? Yeah, somewhere. I don't know. That part of my consciousness is not yet. I haven't memorized where we are now, what street this is, what building this is. So, this sixth sense has a lot of functions, and it relates to the others. And if we look a little closer, how this sixth consciousness is creating in itself a world of experience, the Buddha found out that although this function, this naming and creating images, is very useful, and we need it to function in the world, we often get tricked by it. We often get tricked by what's called perception. English. In Buddhist terminology, this may be very different than other schools of psychology or other spiritual traditions, but perception, very interesting. Again, the Chinese character is part of what? Anybody know? Just the top part. Image. The top part of this character, Xiang, means image. The bottom part, of course, heart or mind, would be consciousness. So perception is an image in the mind, an image in our consciousness. And this is one of the essential things for us to function, know that, oh, this is CUNY, this is such and such a street. We navigate through our life with perception. Even our own name. The guy at the counter asked me, what's your name? I said nothing. How could I function? I couldn't sign my own name. If I couldn't relate to the perception of myself, I couldn't say, oh, I can't say Chang Wen, actually. It's not my legal name. So I have two names. I have to have two perceptions of myself. Actually, I get confused sometimes. I say, what's your name? Let me see your ID. Oh, it's Chang Wen. They give him the idea that's something completely different. And he says, oh, that's my other name. I have to remember that there's two of them. There's two me's. There's two perceptions or two signs.
Only one
for this person. Yeah, thankfully just one person. But two names. And that's really a function of perception. But that's an interesting question. Who is the person? And what does that perception refer to? The Buddha found that the sixth consciousness, this function of perceiving and naming, tends to make us see the world in a very upside-down way, a confused way. I don't know if we would admit to be being confused. Someone asked you, hey, are you confused? Probably wouldn't say yes. According to the Buddha's experience of how we use our perception, we actually take the image and the name in our mind to often be ourself, or to be an external environment. So if someone asks, hey, where are you going tonight? Oh, I'm going to CUNY for a talk. And we have that thought, we have that perception. We really take that perception to be the place we're going to. This is what it is. We think about it. If you were here last week, you know what the room looks like. You have that impression, you know? Well, that's where I'm going. And with this perception, this is, again, very useful. But what happens is that the mind also has a function of attaching. And in the earlier teachings, it's not described as the sixth consciousness, but another function, the seventh consciousness, even an eighth consciousness, and sometimes there's even a ninth consciousness. But it's actually just describing different functions. One is grasping, or attachment. And when we have this perception of a self, this is me. And then objects, this is CUNY, this is other people. Because we grasp onto that perception, we mistake the world to be very fixed. A lot of very permanent things. I myself have some kind of permanence. I'm me. CUNY, it's just a place. Feels like it's always going to be there. The people we relate to, you know, they seem, well, they're just always there. Maybe I don't see what they're doing, I don't see them now, but they're always there. And we get a sense that they're also always the same. So perception, or grasping to perception, makes us feel that things are permanent and also individual. And the Buddha described that mistaken perception as the perception of self. And the grasping or attachment to self. So the consciousness that we have is functioning, and we can do things, we can get along in our life, but we're grasping onto these images and perceptions so much that it makes it feel that, well, there's some degree of permanence to ourself and to the world. And we become confused or ignorant of the fact that it's actually the opposite of permanence. The world is, if everything is impermanent. And it's not a bunch of individuals. And we can't say that someone else is controlling my body, and that there's completely no individuality, but that we perceive it as very distinct, very individual, where in actuality, there's always relationships happening. Physically, you know, if we said, well, my body is myself, it can rely on itself, depend on itself. Were we born by ourselves? Did we bear ourselves? Of course not. But at this moment, we say, well, now I'm here, so now I'm myself. And we can rely on our body as the self. But if this room was devoid of air, how long would our body be ourself? How long would we exist for? Maybe just a couple minutes. Physically, our body needs these other elements to exist. It's not completely independent, although it has some ability to function separately. The body depends on other things, relationships to air, all these other elements, nutrition. And mentally also, you may say, well, my body is not really myself, but my soul is myself. At least my soul is myself. And in some spiritual traditions, that is considered a possibility or reality, that there is something that is permanent, that is completely individual, and that we can rely on. Not to put down any of these other traditions, but according to the Buddha's experience, he saw that, well, the mind or the so-called soul, you can't find such a thing. Although the idea can exist, and it makes us maybe feel safer, according to his observation through meditation, he observed that the mind, all the functions of consciousness, are also changing from moment to moment. Sight, hearing. Can you say that sight is the same from one moment to the next? And then if that was the case, then as soon as I look here, then when I look over there, I'd still be seeing what I saw over here. If sight was permanent, we wouldn't be able to function. The same for all the other senses, and of course, thinking. You know, if thoughts were permanent, if our mind of thoughts is our soul, is our mind, then once we have one thought, then could we have the next thought? If that one thought was permanent, then it wouldn't get out of the way, wouldn't make space for the next thought. So how would we be able to then have this continuous movement of thoughts and able to function? So thoughts are also impermanent. Then it's possible that if we were to experience a state of mind which maybe doesn't have a lot of thoughts, very few thoughts, or maybe an experience where there are none of these, what we just experienced before, or what we talked about as wandering thoughts, the kind of thoughts that are distracting, coming and going, changing. Maybe we have the experience of a very placid, peaceful, stable, what we call completely unified, clear mind. We may feel that this is my mind. This is, at least this is not changing. According to the Buddha, he also saw that, well, there's actually change happening there. There's actually perception happening there. It's very subtle, and like a very scattered mind, it's, you know, something like this. Huge waves of thought. A very stable, meditative state of mind. It's almost like this. Very stable. And so, you don't feel that it's changing. But actually, if you were to magnify this, which really, meditation is a process of magnifying or focusing in on the mind and consciousness, becoming aware of consciousness, you'd see that. If there were some textbooks that do that, magnify this spot, it actually looks like this. There's still movement, there's still perception, and there's still this restlessness, even with that peace and clear mind, where we feel that this is me. Or maybe I'm one with everything. Maybe you've had that experience without even meditating. Have you ever had that experience of just being in a place that you're so relaxed, you're so comfortable, and it just feels like you're almost swimming in the world. You're almost just so connected with everything. You look at things, everything is beautiful. It feels like you're just, you're everything. That kind of experience, although very powerful and stable, still has this perception of self there. There's still this grasping happening. And this grasping at that consciousness, this elemental grasping at this is myself, is this main cause of the restlessness of the mind. And the Buddha called that confusion or ignorance. We're not aware of the fact that that's what we're doing. From moment to moment, grasping. So, what do we do? Well, we only have a few minutes, so we'll have to meditate at some point, which is actually the fourth part of the path of Buddhist practice. The path itself, the practice of mastering our consciousness. We master our consciousness to the point of do something, please don't. I'm afraid. I'm going to erase this line. Ready?
Go for it.
Just erase your consciousness. You should feel very peaceful. The Buddha said something that was very scary in some ways. He said that when you realize the fruit of this practice, this practice of investigating consciousness, you can realize the cessation of the restless mind. And you can also say it's the cessation of consciousness, the ending of the ceasing of consciousness. You may disagree, just wait. It almost looks like, okay, I've just destroyed everything. But actually, I erased the line. There's no line there. But just remember that that line represents a restless mind, restless consciousness. With the ceasing of restless consciousness, you couldn't say this is nothing. If you said it was nothing, that would be right. If you said it was nothing, after the practice, the fruit of the practice, you cease the restless consciousness and then you die. That would be correct. But you couldn't also say that there's something concrete there called consciousness or mind. The Buddha just used the word nirvana to describe it. Nirvana is the absence of restlessness, the absence of desiring, craving, the absence of anger. Usually he talked about it in terms of not being this and not being that. Later in Buddhism, it was called wisdom. In the Chan tradition, a lot of Chan masters used the term Buddha nature. Or, sometimes the nature of awakening. Just so that we don't think that, okay, ending consciousness means there's nothing. There's still the experience of awakening, the experience of wisdom. Wisdom is a mind state free of restlessness. It has the quality of being completely clear, completely stable, but it's without restlessness, without trouble, without vexation. So, now I'll do some animation. Very simple. You could say, this is the restless mind, constantly moving, right? It's all this noise, complaining, or even enjoying things, and then sometimes it's calm, and sometimes it's noisy again, and we go on. This is the restless mind. The mind of wisdom still functions. So you could roughly approximate the mind of wisdom like this. Still has these functions, all of the previous functions, sight, sound, hearing, thinking, imagining, planning, all of those, but it doesn't leave any stains, traces within one's mind. So, and later in Buddhism, there's a term called to transform consciousness, which is the Chinese character is shi, to become wisdom. Zhi, transforming consciousness into wisdom. So this whole process of Buddhist practice, and really with the core of it being meditation, mastering our consciousness, is going from this scattered, restless consciousness, becoming aware of it, using a method to pacify it, but at some point being able to release that grasping, even that grasping onto a peaceful self, a peaceful mind, so that with wisdom, you don't have to be sitting in meditation to be living a life which is very skillful. At the same time being peaceful, at the same time we're active, engaged.